On the 14th day of October, Halloween gave to me 14 brides abiding, 13 Carfax Abbeys, 12 fathers stripping, 11 au pairs drowning, 10 children creeping, 9 Roddy seizing, 8 snowy mazes, 7 bacons digging, 6 doorways bending, 5 children yowling, 4 zombie bulls, 3 haunted mirrors, 2 monster houses, and a fog that makes it hard to see. Hey there, everyone. Happy October 14th. It is a beautiful, what is this, a Wednesday morning? Yeah, it's Wednesday already. It is exciting to be almost halfway done with our journey through the 31 days of Halloween. Oh, it goes so fast, you guys. But we're not going to waste a day. This is going to be a fantastic film. If you've never seen it, I can't encourage this one enough. As you may have noticed, we're on a bit of a vampire kick here lately. We did, of course, the 1979 John Badham directed Dracula, which is, you know, like I was saying in the previous episode, I think it is a lesser known but super fun version of that story. You know, all right, so Brides of Dracula is firmly in the Hammer wheelhouse. This is sort of a sequel to their version of Dracula, Horror of Dracula, I think is what their first one was called. And so this is the follow-up to that. And what makes this interesting, even though it's called Brides of Dracula, there is no Dracula to be found. It is instead a story about a young woman who is on her way to a boarding school where she is to be a French teacher. The lady is played by Yvonne Munlar, who has the most bee-stung lips I think I've ever seen. But anyway, so she, this beautiful young lady gets sidetracked and ends up spending the night at a castle where there is a young man who is being kept away from everyone else, presumably because he has gone mad, and the matriarch of the estate is keeping him captive, keeping him literally chained up. And so through a series of machinations, this pretty young French girl ends up releasing this kid, this son, who of course turns out to be a vampire, and then he goes on a bit of a blood-sucking rampage where he bites his mother and a couple of the girls from the nearby village. And that's kind of the basic setup, right? And then Peter Cushing shows up as Dr. Van Helsing to take care of all the problems here. There are some things that make Brides of Dracula remarkable. One of those things is it is directed by Terence Fisher, who really did the best of all the Hammer movies. He was maybe the best director that Hammer Studios ever had. And he knows how to move a camera. He knows how to stage a shot. It looks beautiful. Like, this is the kind of Hammer movie that when I think of Hammer movies, this is what I think of. It's just this glorious Technicolor. Everything looks gothic and slightly staged, but like it's as if somebody is putting on this grand, expensive gothic play, and it just so happens to be filmed. So there's that. It looks great. It feels great. It feels creepy. It's weirdly divided into these couple of movies where you have this sort of extended sequence with the young girl at this castle and sort of what's going on there and her, you know, machinations to free him. And then it shifts to this boarding school story where there is some of the creepiest, like, vampire imagery I think I've ever seen. One of them being there is a village girl who is attacked and buried in the churchyard. And when she rises from the grave, the housemaid of the castle where the young man lived as a vampire, that handmaiden, who is sort of the Renfield for this vampire, apparently, lays on the ground and coaxes the vampire out of her grave. I'm like, that's it. Just a little more. Keep digging. And it's really eerie. And then, of course, the vampire rises out of the grave. And it's fantastic. It's one of my favorite vampire images ever in a movie ever. It's really terrific. And so there's that. There's one of the most famous, whether you know it or not, you have seen stills from The Brides of Dracula, because there is a young lady named Andre Melly who plays Gina in the film. And I guarantee you at some point you have seen the picture of her as a vampire. She makes a great vampire lady, and there is this running subplot through the film about how the main vampire is ultimately wants this French girl, right? Like, she rescued him and now he's going to make her his bride. But the Greta vampire is a little pissed off about this and is jealous of this other girl, and is kind of needling the vampire, the main vampire, the Baron, as he's called, about, like, hey, you know, why do we even need her? You've got me and you've got this village girl. Like, aren't we enough for you? And so there's that element of it, which I really like. Maybe the biggest drawback of the film is, like all these Hammer movies, it ends pretty suddenly. You know, it's just like, okay, well, we killed the vampire this way. Bada bing, bada boom. Everybody's happy. See you later. That part of it is really my biggest complaint with the movie, because I kind of want to sit and live with it a little bit longer. Like, the movie is only about an hour and a half long, maybe not even 90 minutes, I don't think. Or thereabouts. It's like an hour 32, something small. And the thing that is so, like, compelling about these Hammer movies to me, aside from that kind of theatrical quality, is that they all feel very much of a stripe, but especially with, like, Brides of Dracula and some of the other Terence Fisher-directed stuff, it feels, I hesitate to use the word, but it feels a little elevated from some of the schlockier entries in the series. Don't worry, we're gonna get to one. So Brides of Dracula, though, is maybe my favorite Hammer vampire movie, even though it doesn't feature Christopher Lee at all as Dracula, who I like in that role a tremendous amount. Again, stay tuned. But Brides of Dracula is just, it's creepy. It's different. It's not the story you know, because it's not an adaptation of Dracula. So it's a little bit different. It's got a little bit different moves. There's this tragic melancholy that kind of permeates the movie, both this story of this boy and this, like, almost House of Usher-esque fall of this family as a result of this boy being infected by a vampire. And that melancholy extends to, like, these vampires being jealous of one another, of one, like, eternity is lonely, and why would you want to be alone for that? It's really good. Like, Brides of Dracula, we're not going to make this a giant episode today. I'm just going to tell you, if you've never seen it, Brides of Dracula, I think it's available for free on the Peacock service, but you can also absolutely get it on Amazon and HD for like $4. So I highly recommend, like, if you want to treat yourself right, then get yourself propped on the sofa, get a blanket on you, big comforter, turn the lights down low, and let Brides of Dracula in HD happen to you, and you are going to find yourself having a wonderful time. I can almost guarantee it. As long as you can kind of stomach that style of cinema, that era of cinema, because there is a lot of, and God bless them, there is a lot of Peter Cushing just whipping around and jumping over railings and being the Van Helsing action hero that we all need. And he's great in it, as always. You know, he's very prim and proper, and looks like he's always having a lot of fun. There's a great scene where he gets bitten and has to burn himself so that he is not infected by the Nosferatu. It's just fantastic, man. Like, Brides of Dracula is maybe the pinnacle of Hammer vampire movies. And that came in 1960, and it was all downhill from there. But that doesn't mean we're not going to talk about more, and we'll get to that at a later date. So that's it for Brides of Dracula right now. I can't recommend it enough. Please, 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 if you've never seen it, check out Brides of Dracula. It's a great Halloween movie. Not too creepy, but creepier than you might expect. And it's wonderful. So Speaking of wonderful, have a wonderful Wednesday. Have a creepy Wednesday. And how about you come back tomorrow for another movie here on the Legion Podcast, 31 Days of Halloween. Hey, before I get out of here, we do have a message from one of our listeners. And so this is from Robert, who said, I don't think I deserve to be a, quote, legionnaire. I never got into horror traditions and a nightly film watch like the rest of you. My usual tradition would usually just be rewatching the Halloween and Nightmare on Elm Street films, but I don't know if I'll be able to do that this year. I was thinking about rewatching the Toho Dracula films, though. Those are great. So, look, here's the thing. First of all, if anyone deserves to be called a legionnaire, it is Robert, who has been with us through thick and thin, and I appreciate you so much, man. I'm glad you're part of the family, and hope you enjoy it. So that out of the way, there is no reason to doubt your credentials whatsoever with this here podcast network. But that said, let me say, I don't know that it matters. Like, this is maybe the first time I've ever done literally a movie every day, but I also thought it sounded fun. So here we are. I don't know that you necessarily have to. Like, I'm whether it's a thing you do once a week or even just one night of the month or whatever, if you're celebrating Halloween, that's really what it's about, right? Is just how do you enjoy approaching the season, and hopefully that you're taking the time to enjoy the season, because I find October to be frustratingly fleeting, both the weather, the cool temperatures, and the bright sunshine as the leaves turn. Like, I love that dearly, and I can already see it starting to go away. The leaves are starting to fall, and it's just about gone. And like this month, like, we're almost halfway through it, and boy, it feels so quick. But it's been nice. Like, this is a Halloween I will always look back to as, oh, well, that's the first time I ever did a podcast a day for the 31 days of Halloween. Which I may do again next year. I've enjoyed this a tremendous amount. So, again, back to the original point, doesn't matter how you do it, so long as you're doing it, so long as you're enjoying it and appreciating it and doing the things that makes you happy in terms of celebrating, because nobody knows how you enjoy Halloween more than you. So if it's rewatching the Elm Street movies and Halloween movies, then do that. If it is, hey, maybe once in a while I throw on a creepy movie, then do that. If it's, oh, I enjoy listening to these podcasts and just thinking about Halloween and horror movies and stuff like that, then do that. It is, as with everything, it is a personal thing, but it is also something we can share. Like, the ways that we celebrate Halloween may all be different, but the fact that we're celebrating Halloween is the thing that brings us all together. So if you would like to reach out as well, and thank you for doing so, you can reach me at Bo at legionpodcasts.com. If you go to the website, you can also see a link right there to my email address. So feel free to click that, smash that email button, and send me a message. Subject line Halloween, if you want, to let me know what it is that you're talking about. And that's going to do it for today. So all done. Thanks again for listening, and I will see you tomorrow.